Really nice to see you. Welcome to Grace Church. Whether it's your first time here or whether you've been here hundreds of times before, it's a delight to see those here in person, but also those online as well. As you know, everything you're going to need for today's service is going to be on this screen. But what we're going to do is, because it feels a little bit chaotic with people coming in, we're just going to have a minute to take stock and prepare ourselves for today's service. So a moment just to pray and to prepare ourselves and think about the service ahead. So yeah, let's take a moment just to stop and to think as people come and take their seats as well. And so we're going to start our service today by a confession. So it should be coming up on the screen. Take a moment just to read it. There's obviously no pressure to join, but it's an opportunity for us to come before God and say sorry for the things that we've done wrong this week and ask him to forgive us. So a moment just to cast your eyes over it. And then if you'd like to, please join me as I say this confession together. Okay. Most merciful Father, we confess before your awesome majesty that we have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have sinned against you in thought, in words and actions, through negligence, through weakness, and through our own deliberate fault. According to your great promises to us in Christ, forgive us and cleanse us, and for the sake of your pleasure and glory, renew us by your Holy Spirit, that we would hate what is wrong and love what is right, living a disciplined, humble, and godly life, rejoicing in you, our God. Amen. If you have said those words and meant them, you can be certain that God has forgiven you. In Psalm 103, it says, "The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from us." Let's pray. Father God, thank you that you are so awesome and so powerful. Thank you that you're also full of mercy, grace and compassion. Father, thank you that you have heard our prayer of confession, that you've forgiven us. Thank you that you are our Father as well as our King. Father, thank you that you are eternal, that you've always existed and that you'll always exist. Thank you that as Christians that we will always enjoy the benefits of being your children and that only Jesus deserves. Father, thank you that we can meet together as your church. Please use today's service to change us, to be more like you. Amen. So I'm not sure how you found Easter, but it's been a great opportunity to remember all that Jesus has achieved for us through his death and resurrection, knowing that he's defeated death. And because he's done that, we no longer need to fear our own deaths. And so we're going to stand and sing together. And as we sing, let's remember all that Jesus achieved for us over Easter. And it's a come people of the risen King. So let's stand and sing.
Born and cheer your hearts to sing to the Lord.
Singing. Please take your seats. So for the kids' thought this morning, we're going to think about one of the characteristics of God, and that God is eternal. A big long word, but we'll get to understand what it means. But Marley, I think you're going to come and read for us. Thank you very much.
Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are the God.
Brilliant. Thank you very much from Psalm chapter 90. Okay, so to start this, I want you to think about the oldest person that you know. Okay, you don't need to necessarily shout out if you want to, but think in your mind about the oldest person you know. Okay, over Easter, we as a family went to visit my grandma. She's 94, which is pretty impressive. 94. Okay, does anyone know anyone older than 94? Yep, yeah, at the back. 95. Who is it?
My nan.
Brilliant. Okay, 95. Can anyone beat 95? Yeah, Marilyn. 100. Well done. Okay, Ezra. Pretty good. Yep, Charlie? 118 is the world record. Okay, so that is pretty old. Okay, and also, I don't know if people saw it, I think it was this week or recently, the Queen just celebrated her 96th birthday. So she's pretty good, not quite 118, but 96 is pretty good. Okay. Do you think the Queen, or even the person who's in the Guinness World Records, 118, okay, were they born before or after the Alps and the Himalayas were made? Who's older, the mountains or the Guinness World Record oldest person, 118? It's an easy question. It's the mountains. The mountains were definitely there even before the oldest person. Okay, another easy question. Look at the verse, who existed before the mountains and before the world was made? Yep, God did, that's right. Okay, it's hard to understand, isn't it? But God had no start. He has always been there. If you can think back to the earliest possible time, he was there then, he was there before then, he is always existed, yeah? And he will always exist. He's never going to die, and he's always going to be there. Okay, my grandma, who went to go and visit, she's amazing, and I really enjoyed going to visit her. But sadly, one day she's going to die, and until I get to heaven, I won't be able to see her anymore. But that is not the case with God. God is always going to be there with me, yeah? He's always going to be there for you. He's always going to be there to keep his promises. He's always going to be there to help you. And that's the thought for today, that God is eternal. It means he didn't have a start and he's never, ever going to have an end. It's amazing, isn't it, to think that God is always there. He's always going to be there for us. Okay, so we're going to respond to that as we think about that amazing fact that God is eternal by saying the Lord's Prayer together, which will be on the screen. Okay, let's say these words together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, forever and ever. Amen. So it's amazing to think, isn't it, that God's eternal, that he's never had a start and he's never had an end. And we're going to think about that as we sing our next song, that he's always there for us, that he never changes. And we're going to be able to praise him and thank him for that by singing a song, Faithful One, So Unchanging, that God is always there and not just eternal. He never changes. He's the same yesterday as he is today and will be the same tomorrow. So let's stand and praise him for that.
Faithful, so unchanging.
Seats. So it's time for mini kids and for younger kids to go out to their lessons. But before I pray for you, I just wanted to say a big thank you to Sarah, Sarah Mackay. You may not know, but this is her last mini kids. So she has been doing this, I think, Sarah, you said for 10 years. So for a long time, and over the last, I think, few years, really revamped Mini Kids and set up the vision of what they're looking to achieve. So a personal thanks from me for looking after my children at some stage over the last 10 years, but also for the church as well. And thank you for all that you've done for us. Okay, let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for each and every person at Grace Church. But Lord, especially a special thank you for all of the kids, younger kids and mini kids. Lord, help them to enjoy their lesson, to hear more about you, and to see you more clearly. Lord, we long for each of our children to that they would know and love you. Thank you for the role of Mini Kids in that. Thank you for the role of Sarah over the last decade and for others. Please continue to bless her in all that she does. Please help all of the children in today's session and the leaders as well. Amen. Kids, have a great time. Right, as they go out, maybe say hello to the person next to you. Brilliant. I'm just going to pull us all back together. Before we look at the notices, I'm always amazed. It shouldn't surprise me, given the number of children we have. But when I look out, we were rammed. Every seat was taken. There's loads of people sitting at the back. And now we've got quite a few spaces with all the kids going out. So it's good to see. Right. In terms of notices, people are back at school tomorrow, which I'm sure all the children are delighted about. So impact. It's starting again tomorrow. However, there's no SALT. So SALT, you've got an additional week off. There's community groups that are happening as usual. Other things and dates for your diaries. There's the big breakfast. We'll be looking at anxiety. That's 9 till 10:30 on Sunday, the 15th of May. So 9 till 10:30, Sunday, the 15th of May. Anything else? We've got the church weekend away as well, 8th to the 10th of July. Put it in your diaries, keep that weekend free. When we've had church weekends before, if you've not been there, they're loads of fun. And generally we get the whole church together. So really good time away. Make sure you get them in your diaries, 8th to the 10th of July. Anything I've missed?
No, we'll get details about church weekend away pretty soon.
Cool, yeah, so look out for those. Details will be coming out about what we're doing. All right, Bethan, I'm looking for you. There you are. I'm going to hand over to you, and we're hoping there's going to be no technical difficulties, and you're going to interview Vicky.
If there are any technical difficulties, I can do nothing about it. Okay. So I'm going to be interviewing the lovely Vicky Ardan, who many of you know, but haven't seen for quite a while because we've had to sort of follow COVID rules to the most strict level. Oh, there she is.
Hello, Bethan. And hello, everybody else.
This is.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, can you make that loud one? Hang on, Vicky.
Can you hear me all right, Bethan?
Yes, we can. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. That's great. Yes.
Victory is ours.
Yes.
Well, we're here today to get to know you a little bit. So for those of you who don't know you particularly well, could you just introduce yourself and tell us a bit about you?
Well, I've had a very varied life. Moved from Oxford up to the north of England, and then down to Wales, and then back to Worcestershire, and then I came over here. So I'm used to lots of change, and started off as a teacher. But when I moved to Wales, I couldn't teach. And so I went into farming, which was what I really wanted to do. And then I moved to working for places like the State Veterinary Service and stuff, and moved on to a narrow boat. And then when my chest condition got too bad, I moved over here, as my younger daughter lives in Hayward Heath. So, and I decided that I would like to live in Bolner because I went to a couple of services with my grandson and my daughter before I moved over here. So, yes, I feel extremely blessed to live where I am. And I think Bolner is a wonderful village. and I really enjoy the many amenities, you know, being close to town, walking in the woods. You know, it's reasonably quiet and walking around with not so much traffic if you pick the right time. So, yes, and to be able to come to Grace Church, well, when I can.
That's wonderful. And I think when you said you had a varied life, I love mentioning, oh, yes, she's a farmer and she lived on a narrow boat. So it's you're very cool, actually. So that's wonderful. So could you tell us, for someone who's had a varied life and used to being out and about, what has your experience of lockdown been?
Well, actually, I think because I've lived in isolated places, when, you know, from kind of my, when I got married and everything, and I've always been quite self-sufficient, and of course, being in farming, you're on your own an awful lot. I'm quite a very practical person. I like to be busy. I'm an early riser, and I like to have a list of jobs to do every day. So I think that from that point of view, and my faith, I think that has played a massive part in my life. I was brought up in, I suppose my parents called themselves Christians, but they weren't practicing Christians. But my grandmother and my aunt had a tremendous influence on me. And I used to go to church with them when I stayed with them. And my aunt was a Sunday school teacher. And it's, yes, and I think then I was always fascinated by church, and I just loved the feeling that I got by going to church. And I was confirmed at 13, and soon after that I was quite seriously ill and thought I would die, and I reached out to the Lord. And I think that was something that really confirmed my faith, because I'm still here. And yes, and I think another time is when I was driving the tractor, and the tractor went into the slurry pit 18 feet down. The doors and windows were all tied up with bale of twine, and I think your whole life flashes before you. And I called out to the Lord then.
Yeah.
I managed to walk out over the slurry. Don't ask me how, but I was all right. But I think that, you know, when you've had experiences like that and you realise that the Lord does watch over you and walk closely with you, and I think that the times when things haven't been good for me in my life is when perhaps I haven't been as focused on the Lord as I should be. And so lockdown for me, I was quite lucky, apart from having to isolate from people, and you know, I haven't really touched anybody since before lockdown started, because I realised for me that I was vulnerable, even though it took weeks for the NHS to catch up on that fact. But yes, I've been very fortunate, and I'm so thankful to John for doing the little videos he put out to encourage us, for, you know, Grace Church doing Zoom and community groups. You know, Thursday night prayer is brilliant. I love that. And so, yes, I think it's just about being positive and realising that, you know, you can't change what's happening in the world. You've got to learn to embrace it. And I think because I've had so much change, done different careers, moved around, nothing is static in my life anyway. So it doesn't particularly faze me, but I just trust in the Lord. And I haven't been a person who's questioned my faith a lot. I just know it. And my time with the Lord really is to go out early in the morning walking and spending time praying then. And I can, you know, I feel the Lord near. So I, you know, I just, I would just say to the young children in the church that, you know, don't turn your back on him, because life's never quite the same. Things will, you know, you need, he's a constant person in my life, where everything else is changing, but the Lord doesn't change. And even when you don't particularly feel engaged with him, he's always there, and he brings you back into the fold, and he forgives and gives you a second chance. And yes, I mean, I just feel very blessed, very privileged in what I have in my life. And if I die tomorrow, it doesn't faze me at all. It doesn't worry me.
You are such an encouragement to us, Vicky. It's wonderful to hear of your resilience, but also your resilience has been born from faithfulness and trust in the Lord. So it's wonderful to see that, because someone else could have been a bit more woe is me, and you've had a very different attitude throughout lockdown, and it's been an encouragement to the rest of us, although we have missed you dearly.
I've missed it, and I think that just before Easter, when I was so poorly, and it wasn't COVID, I thought it was COVID, but all the PCR tests and natural flows were negative, but I was really poorly. And because I suffer from chronic fatigue as well, that was really debilitating. And I have found the last couple of weeks, 3 weeks or so, quite difficult. It's not that I don't believe in the Lord, but I just feel that, I find it difficult. I'm just finding that difficult at the moment. And then, of course, they refused my fourth jab and said, because I wasn't an immunosuppressant. And that was just about the last straw when I felt so poorly and was taking quite a time to get over, because I was hoping that maybe it would give me a bit more opportunity to come out and mix with people. But they just said, don't catch COVID because you'll need additional medication, additional support at home, you know, and stuff. And I just can't face going through what I did when I first got, you know, chronic fatigue, because I couldn't see. I could only get out of bed and walk to a chair for 5 minutes and then had to lie down again. So I think if I caught COVID, it would probably, you know, be quite onerous for me from the recovery point of view.
Absolutely. So how can we be praying for you, Vicky, and what can we do for you?
It's just nice to, to be able to join the, you know, prayer and church and community group. And I think just to give me a bit more strength at the moment in my prayer life, just so that I can focus, because my concentration is terrible at the moment. And I find that quite difficult, because I feel that I'm not being faithful enough, and that's hard, you know, because I know what the Lord does for me every day. I only have to look outside to look at what he's created. And, you know, and I think I beat myself up about it, you know, so, yes.
Well, we're going to pray for you now, Vicky. It's been lovely to have for everyone to get to know you, because the church has actually grown since you were last physically here. So your prayers for us are really appreciated, and it's now our chance to pray for you. Let's pray.
Thank you.
Father God, we do pray and thank you for our precious sister, Vicky. We miss her, but we are so grateful that we are united in Christ, and that even when we can't physically be with her, we know that we are one because we share in you. We thank you so much for the resilience she's shown over the last 2 years. We thank you for her faith that has grown and grown visibly. We thank you for her faithfulness in prayer, the fact that she's always at the prayer meeting, she's always involved thinking about this in prayer. We thank you for that. And as she has requested, Lord, we pray that you would continue to walk alongside her in that prayer, that your spirit would give her the words she needs. We thank you for her outward looking attitude, her thankful heart. And we pray, we know that's in step with your spirit, Lord. So we pray for more and more of your spirit to uphold and strengthen her and steer her prayers towards your glory. So we thank you for that, Lord. We pray too for her health. We pray that you give her the strength for each day, the positivity to not get down about it. But ultimately, Lord, we pray for healing. We pray that she would, now we're getting into the warmer months, she'd have fewer and fewer infections, that she'd feel more and more strength, and that she would continue to enjoy walking out into your beautiful creation that she is so grateful and appreciative of. We thank you for the daily blessings that she acknowledges. And we pray too as a church that we would remember Vicky in our prayers, that we'd remember to text her, to meet her for a walk, and that she would feel very much part of this church family. We thank you for her and all that she means to us, and pray that you would bless her today and always. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Vicky.
Thank you very much, Bethan. We're going to continue our time of prayer. So I'm going to lead us in prayer, but take some requests from the floor. So is there anything that you would like us as a church to pray about? It could be big, it could be small, it could be something to thank God for, it could be something to ask him for. Anything, all stick up your hand or shout it out, and I'll include it in the prayers. Kev? Pray for that. Thank you, Kevin. Yep. Thanks, Kaylee. Yeah, Bethan.
The kids going back to school tomorrow, that they would.
Brilliant. Yeah, Vicky.
We're praying for the ex-school preparations over the next one.
Yep, thank you. Yep.
What about with 3-16-year-old UKs who are looking for a nurse on my stay, and potentially you say that we potentially want to stay together?
Yeah, thank you. Any more for any more? Yep.
He's got his final work due on Thursday.
So his dissertation or?
Yeah.
Yep. Oh yeah, he's doing the course, yeah, definitely. Okay, brilliant. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for the privilege of prayer. Thank you that we can come before you, knowing that you are an eternal God, that you have had no start, that you will never end, that you'll never change. Knowing that nothing is too difficult for you, and you are listening to me, you are listening to us as we pray together at your church. Thank you so much for all that you have given us. Thank you for Easter. Thank you that we could remember that you have defeated death. Help us to remember that and to not be concerned or worried about our own mortality, our own death. And Lord, thank you for the good things that you have given us. Lord, for the sunshine outside, for the walk that we could have this morning for some of us from the church, for holidays that many people have enjoyed. Lord, also, we ask that you would continue to work globally. Lord, we look at the suffering in Ukraine with the war there, and we don't really know what to do, but thank you that you do. And we pray that you would guide that situation, that you would be with each individual that's suffering. Lord, we think of this group of 3 16-year-olds, that they're looking for somewhere to stay. Please help them to be able to find that, and that they would be housed in the right place. Lord, also for other things going on, the French election, help people to be wise in who they vote for, and please use the leader of that country and for our government as well. Lord, we think of people who are unwell in the church. Lord, for Kevin with these stomach problems. For Vicky, who we've just heard from Adele, for Claire, for Tom with his broken arm and COVID. Lord, for Kaylee with her back, for Juliet. Lord, please help each of these people and please heal them. But also thank you for Abby. Please continue to help her as she expects her next child, and please keep her and the child safe. Lord, as people go back to school, help them to be able to do that well. Thank you so much for the Christian unions at Oak Hall and Woodham Park, and please continue to use them. Lord, for Joel, as he's under a lot of stress and pressure at the moment, as he completes his dissertation, help him to rely upon you. Give him the words as he writes and help him to be able to get everything done. Lord, also for the children that face exams, help them not to feel too stressed and for that to be okay. Lord, also thank you that Gavin can do this course with work, and please help him and the family as he's away. Lord, also for the things coming up, thank you for by the beach next weekend and for the a few of us that can go there. And Lord, also for Explore 014, thank you for the way that you've used that so powerfully to work in many of our children's lives. Please do that again this time round. And Lord, be with Vicky and Claire and other leaders as they prepare for that, and help that just to be a great time. Thank you that you are such a good God. Thank you for all that you provide for us individually and for a church. And thank you for your ongoing blessing. Amen. Okay, so we're going to sing two songs now. The first one, Happy Day, celebrates that all Jesus achieved for us through his death and resurrection. And the second one, Because of You, reminds us that as Christians, what we're going to experience in heaven, a list of amazing things we're going to sing, but amongst them is seeing Jesus face to face. An amazing thing that as Christians we'll do when we're in heaven. So let's stand and sing these two songs together.
Glory spread. That you have saved me.
Standing, and maybe one or two can just pray or read a verse in response to what you've just sung.
Well, we thank you so much for this image of heaven. So exciting to think about dancing and feasting, and most of all, Lord, seeing you face to face. We just pray that we will live our lives in the knowledge of that, that things are changing for us, whether they're good or bad, that you are constant, you are there.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for the blessed assurance we have in Christ that this hope that we have in heaven is not something that can be taken away from us, because Jesus really has risen and he has called us as his people, as his sheep. So we have that certain hope that Vicky was talking about, that even if we should die tomorrow, we have the absolute certainty we will be with Christ, our Saviour, our Lord. We'll see him face to face. Thank you. That is a certain hope for Christians this morning. We have. Thank you for your grace to us to sing it. I give it to us.
Amen. Father God, thank you for who you are and for all that you have done. Thank you for everything that was achieved through Jesus's death and resurrection. Thank you that death and sin and the devil have been defeated. Thank you that we can have that certainty of knowing that we have been adopted into your family, that we are your sons and daughters, and that we will spend eternity with you. Lord, such a joy, such a blessing, something that only really Jesus deserves. But thank you that you have given it to us. Father God, also thank you so much for your word. And Lord, as we come to it now here in the service and as older kids go out, please speak to us. Reveal more of yourself to us. Help us to be even more amazed at who you are and what you have done. Amen. Please take your seats. Older kids, have a great time in Kids at Four. And before John comes and preaches, Bernard, I think you're going to come and do the reading. If people want to look it up while Bernard is coming up, it's Hebrews chapter 11, verses 8 to 19.
It's a reading from Hebrews 11, verses 8 to 19. By faith, Abram, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. And by faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children, because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and he as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, as countless as the sand on the seashore. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting they were foreigners and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. Sorry. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he prepared a city for them. By faith, Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had embraced the promise was about to sacrifice his one and only son, even though God had said to him, "It is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned." Abraham reasoned that God could even raise the dead, and so in a manner of speaking, he did receive Isaac back from death.
Thank you so much, Bernard, and welcome from me to you all. If you're a guest here or online, my name's John. I'm minister here at Grace Church, and we're doing a one-off today. Tom, bless him, is due to be preaching, but has got the double whammy of broken arm and COVID as he's come back from his holiday. So I pulled out of the bag a sermon on Abraham because we were going to look at a character study. And so we're thinking about Abraham today. So if you could turn back to Genesis chapter 22, Genesis 22, and we're going to think of that event, incredible event of God asking him to sacrifice Isaac that Hebrews has just been talking about. And when you've got to Genesis 22, can anyone give me a page number for everyone else? Page 22. Genesis 22, page 22. That's nice and easy. And let's pray, shall we? Father, we recognise hearing from Vicky earlier and recognise as well with Tom unable to be here today that the lives you call us to are not always easy and filled with ups and downs. And so as we come to this incredible event that teaches us so much on how to deal with those ups and downs, Lord, that you would speak to us of yourself and of the faith that you work within us. Help me, Lord, to teach it faithfully and clearly, and all of us as we listen, to be changed and strengthened and encouraged in the knowledge of you, our great and glorious Heavenly Father. Amen. So we're going to read chapter 22, 1 through to 18. Sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham," "Here I am," he replied. Then God said, "Take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain I will show you." Early the next morning, Abraham got up and loaded his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. And when he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place God had told him about. And on the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. He said to his servants, "Stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. And as the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father, "Abraham, father?" "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "The fire and wood are here," Isaac said, "but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham answered, "God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." And the two of them went on together. When they reached the place God had told him about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. And then he reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham!" "Here I am," he replied. "Do not lay a hand on the boy," he said. "Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God, because you've not withheld from me your son, your only son." Abraham looked up, and there in the thicket he saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." And to this day it is said, "On the mountain of the Lord it will be provided." The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me." So says God's word. Now, I wonder what you would say have been the high points of your Christian life. You know, it may be a time, perhaps at university, when you're really going strong for the Lord and you had great fellowship in a Christian union or something like that. It may be a retreat or a conference that you remember was so significant, a book perhaps that you read, or it might be just being out on the downs, walking and just communing with the Lord. Those are the great high points. I wonder how many of us would say our high point was a time of trial. If you like, our high point was at the same time a low point. Our high point was when we were going through the valley of the shadow of death. You see, we often don't think about those as high points, do we? But actually, Abraham here is displaying his faith at its best in the time when he was faced with the worst. You see, the real test of strength is when weight has to be lifted, isn't it? Kids, if you're gonna just remember an illustration today to just embed this, think about walking with the Lord like being in the gym with a trainer, okay? The trainer sometimes gives us quite easy weights to lift because that's good for general health, isn't it? But sometimes a good trainer is going to say, you need to do a few less reps of something really hard now, because you need to build up some bulk. You need to build up some muscle. That's important too. And so as we go on through life, the Lord, our trainer, in the everyday, gives us the easier things to lift in faith. And that's fine. But sometimes in his great wisdom, he will give us heavyweights, times of trial and testing, to show actually how healthy we really are, to strengthen us in our faith and service. And what Abraham shows is that this really is a lifelong thing. You see, if we were to look at the life of Abraham, we would see that although he is the man the Bible points us to more than any other as the man of faith, it wasn't always a kind of, "I'm really on the up all the time." Abraham goes through lots of struggles and problems. You know, God had promised Abraham that he would have this glorious land and as many descendants as the stars in the sky through a son born to him and Sarah. But over these 30 years in the gym of discipleship, Abraham didn't always trust God fully in that. Rather than trust that God would therefore protect his life and that of his wife, when he went to Egypt and faced Pharaoh and another time Abimelech, he lied both times saying Sarah was his sister because he was worried he might be put to death. Well, Abraham wouldn't be put to death. Does God keep his promise? But Abraham was struggling to believe that. Again, God had said that this son would come to him and Sarah, but do you remember how Abraham said to Eliezer, his servant, maybe you could be my heir, we'll have the great nations through you. And yeah, Hagar, well, let's have a child, Ishmael, and maybe the great nation could become that way. He wasn't trusting in God's promise. So there were times of struggle, but during those times of struggle, God was testing Abraham again and again to strengthen his faith so that he would become the man the Lord wanted him to be. And so at other times, he trusts God wholly. When Lot comes and wants part of the land, Abraham says, take whatever you want. Why? Well, because the Lord's given it to me. I trust him. So you take whatever you want from it. And when Lot and his family are taken by other kings and there's a threat to them, Abraham's quite happy then to go out and do battle. There he's not fearing for his life because that day is a day of faith. I love that. I think that's so encouraging. One day he's struggling in faith. The next day he's doing really well because that's our experience. But through it all, his heavenly trainer is training him. And what we get to in chapter 22 is we get to the real pinnacle, the great test. Now I'm asking you to bench press whatever it is, 200 kgs. I don't even know what a heavy bench press is, but imagine it is a heavy one. Well, as Abraham engages with it, there are a number of lessons for us. You'd think that the great point for Abraham is actually in the previous chapter when Isaac is finally born after 25 years of waiting, but we only have 7 verses for that. But as we come to chapter 22, we have a whole chapter engaging with the threat to him. C.H. Spurgeon himself said this: we have no more faith at any time than we have in the hour of trial. And all that will not bear to be tested is mere carnal confidence. In God's providence, it was wonderful actually hearing from Vicky, wasn't it? Hearing from someone who has gone through ups and downs in life. I didn't even know the story about the slurry. I was trying to picture that. But however it was, the Lord brought her through that. In the last 2 years, how he's given her faith and her faith has shone as gold, keeping on trusting. But for those of us younger in the faith and in life, well, we've got a whole life, haven't we, of these kind of challenges that are going to come to us. From our heavenly trainer, are we going to trust him? Are we going to come forth as gold? That's the question that comes before us today. And this passage can be a real help. So do you think, as we begin, how your faith is being tested at the moment? I think, you know, a day doesn't go by in which is tested in some way. For many, it will be just the day-to-day struggle with the things that might get us down or cause us to doubt. But it may be, well, I know for some of you, that at the moment it's a bigger weight, isn't it, that you're having to carry. A bigger crisis. Well, 4 points for us, whatever it might be. First one, be ready for these times. Don't let them take you by surprise. You know, I think when I was a young Christian, sometimes, you know, people would act as if God's great purpose in life is to keep us in this lovely, happy place the whole time. You know, that's his great priority for us. But it doesn't take long in life, does it, to realize that no, he's got a higher purpose than that. Sometimes the Lord intentionally puts us through difficulty. It might be because of what he's going to do in us. It might be for what he's going to do through us by others seeing how we respond. You see, it's a shock to see that Abraham's faith has got to survive a great trial that comes from the Lord. Let's look at verses 1 and 2. Sometime later, God tested Abraham and said, Abraham, here I am. He replied. He said, take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah, sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain. I will show it to you. This is a test. God is asking the hardest possible thing of this man to test him. Now, God knows Abraham's heart, so it's not, I'm not quite sure, Abraham, how you're going to do on this, so let's put you through something to see how you will. No, the test is for Abraham's sake, isn't it? He wants Abraham to see how he will do. He wants his descendants, he wants us to learn from this test that Abraham's going through. Just as often when he tests us, he shows something to us and to those who look on. And just consider the nature of this test. God is asking Abraham to sacrifice what is most precious to him. If we're to do true justice to this, you know, you can't read it without crying, really, can you? Just think about what really is being asked of him here. The son he'd waited 25 years for, God now says, put him to death. And as if to make the point, and I don't think it's because, you know, the Lord loves to sort of, you know, press on our bruises and rub salt in the wounds. It's because he wants to show the wonder of Abraham's faith that he has worked in him. He stresses, doesn't it? Take Isaac, that's your son, that's your only son, the son you love. You know, he's really driving it home, isn't he? But there's more, isn't there? God had promised Abraham a multitude of descendants, nations, kings, and blessing through this one son, Isaac. So God's seemingly saying, look, I'm going to put an end to all that because I want you now to put the one who is the only way of this promise coming to pass to death. And if that's not hard enough, Moriah, likely this is where Jerusalem was built, is about a 3 days walk. So God's asking Abraham to spend 3 days thinking about this. You know, we all know, don't we, when we've got something hard coming up, the more time we have to think about it, the more time we've got to back out. And, you know, it's not in the world where he can just, you know, be on his phone or his iPad all the time, you know, not really thinking about it. You know, there's nothing to do as you walk 3 days in the ancient Near East, except look up at the stars that will remind him of God's promise through Isaac and think about what God's really asking of him. The story is told of an old Methodist preacher praying in a meeting, Lord, help us to trust you with our souls. And it's that kind of church where everyone says, Amen. I'm not expecting you to do that. And then he says, Lord, help us to trust you with our bodies. And Amen from everywhere. He's getting a bit warmed up, the preacher. Lord, help us to trust you with our money. Except for the poor old lady over there with no money at all who says, Amen. It's like that, isn't it? How will we fare when God asks us to give up what is most precious? There's a sense in which every moment of obedience tests our faith, doesn't it? Will I trust God and therefore obey, or will I go my own way? But the particular tests that really show where we're at with the Lord are when he says, I want what's precious to you. Remember that rich young ruler who came to Jesus? You know, I've kept all the commandments. Okay, sell everything you've got and give it to the poor. And then he walked away. Jesus was asking for Isaac, wasn't he? But we must remember in that God is asking nothing of us that he wouldn't be willing to give himself. That's got to be one of the lessons here, hasn't it? You can't read this whole event without remembering John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his one, his only son. Or his words at Jesus' baptism, this is my son whom I love. So resonant, isn't it, of what he's saying about Isaac. God calls us not ultimately to emulate Abraham, but to emulate him. He gave what was most precious to him, his eternal son. And he calls us to be ready to give what is most precious to us for his sake. So what is that for you, for me? You know, it might be the need to give money that we are holding on to. It might be to give up a relationship that's wrong. It might be to forsake immediate happiness in order to do what's right, to give up your time or interests or your desire to be affirmed, to continue in that often thankless task of being a parent or caring for family members that aren't always easy. Perhaps it's to risk the esteem of others by admitting you're a Christian at school or in the office, risk a job by doing what's right and what's ethical. It might be even to risk our children, in a sense, by being willing to move overseas or to a rough area of a city in order to serve the Lord. All those things are challenges, aren't they, to our faith? And the key question is, when God brings those moments on us, will those low points, if you like, be our high points? When our trainer says, go on, have a go lifting this, you know, will we step forward and say, yes, I'm going to, in your strength, my Lord? Will we trust and obey? Be ready then for testing. But second, be faithful in ignorance. You see, God's call here is shocking. It's intended to get our attention, isn't it? And we must remember that it doesn't come as an idea in Abraham's mind that he just concludes is from God. Being ready to do such a thing on that basis would be awful, wouldn't it? I think God's telling me to go sacrifice my son. And I think, as an aside, we just need to acknowledge that we should be very cautious of making big decisions because we feel the Lord might be saying something. I could list to you stories over the years of people that have come a cropper by making decisions on that basis. No, when we make big decisions, we wait on the Lord, we pray until we have a sense of clarity through the principles of his word, the counsel of his people, and the openings of his providence. It's like, you know, going for a great hike. You've got your map, which is the Bible that tells you the routes to go. You've got the council of local people that tell you the conditions are right for it or not. And then you've got whether the path is closed or not that might stop you from going. That's generally how we make decisions. In extreme cases, there might be a vision or a dream that the Lord gives. But here with Abraham, it's even more than that, because this is the biggest decision he could ever make. Verse 15 tells us an angel of the Lord speaks to him from heaven. So there was no doubt in Abraham's mind this was what God was asking him to do. Clarity, certainty, audibility, consistent with a relationship with Abraham the Lord has had for 30 years. And I guess in some ways the equivalent for us is when God sends not an angel but his son, who says, if anyone would come after me, they must take up their cross daily and follow. They must be willing to sacrifice themselves for my sake. That is to give what is most precious. That's, I guess, the equivalent. To put his will first. Well, we've already mentioned some of the ways we might have to bear our own cross. That difficult family situation, enduring hostility from those who resent our faith, pouring ourselves out in service, honouring the Lord despite ill health. No, for Abraham, what is uncertain is not what God wants, but what God is doing. That's the ignorance he's got. He just can't comprehend exactly what's going on here. Imagine the confusion in his mind. God's made a promise to him through Isaac. The whole world's going to be blessed. You're going to have great descendants, as many as the stars in the sky. But now I want you to kill him. There's no way that Abraham really has got the faculties to quite know what's going on. He's ignorant, but called to be faithful. Isn't that often the case when we go through times of trial? People I've sat down with over the years who've really suffered, and it's quite understandable. They'll say, why is God doing this? And I have to say, I don't really know. It doesn't mean he hasn't got a reason. It just means that he asks us to be faithful in our ignorance. And that's usually the way, actually, isn't it? We love being quite rational people. We love to think we can find the reason. And that reassures us if we think we can possibly see what God might be doing. But sometimes we just don't know. And he doesn't ask us to understand. He asks us to trust. So Abraham didn't just have to obey God, he had to trust him. He had to trust that God had a way through. Well, trust is just what he did. Verse 3, note that phrase, early the next morning. What's that telling us? You know, Abraham is not reluctant to obey at this point in his life. God shaped him. He gets up early to get on with what he's being asked to do. No delay, no debate, no struggle. God says, Abraham does. It's a challenge to our often slow. I think there's that story Jesus says, doesn't he, of the one who says no and then eventually does, and the one who says yes and never does it. You know, I'm not unlike many people. I'm kind of the no, and eventually might reluctantly, by the grace of God, get around to doing it. But Abraham's not like either of those. He just gets on with it. Even when he's being asked to give what's most precious. And so the story builds. He takes two servants. He takes Isaac. He cuts the wood for the burnt offering. They set out. 3 days later, they arrive. Abraham puts the wood on Isaac's back to carry. Here, it seems that Isaac's, if you like, carrying his cross. And Isaac says, where's the offering, Dad? And it seems Abraham is starting to recognize it's a test. So he presumes, well, when they get there, God's going to provide something. And so he says, look, verse 8, God's going to provide the lamb. But none is provided. And so Abraham's tested further. You can imagine him getting there and thinking, well, you know, I thought God was just seeing if I'd come this far and the lamb's going to be there. But there's no lamb. So what was he going to do? Well, he builds the altar. And he lays Isaac on it. We're not supposed to read these things sort of flippantly and think, oh, yeah, I know the story. We're supposed to be shocked. Verse 10 causes us to catch our breath. He reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. It's a shame, really, that most of us know the story. Because you're supposed to stop and think, could he? Would he? I wonder if you picked up in our first reading in Hebrews. It tells us at this point that Abraham, through the eyes of faith, is reasoning this. God's promised through Isaac, these descendants, this nation, the whole world being blessed. He's asking me to put Isaac to death. And I know he always keeps his promises. The only possible way this is going to work out, therefore, is that he's going to raise Isaac from the dead for it to be fulfilled. His faith is that strong. And so he really is ready to do it. But God intervenes. Verse 11. The angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, Abraham, Abraham, here I am, he replied. Do not lay a hand on the boy, he said. Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God because you've not withheld from me your son. There it is again, your only son. I picked up a story of a grocer down in the cellar of his shop when he noticed his small son standing at the edge of the stairs at the top by a sort of open trap door. You can picture it. Dad's down here, son's up there. And he calls up, son, jump down. And his son says, well, Dad, I can't see you. Because, of course, from the lid up upstairs into the dark downstairs, it's just jumping into a hole. The dad says, no, it doesn't matter. I can see you, and I'm going to catch you. So because the son trusts his dad, he jumps. His dad catches him. And there's joy. And isn't that what God is asking us to do whenever we go through times of trial, whenever our faith is being tested? To do the right thing, even though we're not going to know the outcome, to jump, trusting that he's going to catch us, to jump into the darkness. When it comes to gospel, we don't actually know, do we? You know, exactly what it's going to be like. We've just got to trust. You know, as I face death one day and I'm looking into the darkness, I'm jumping. I'm trusting everything I've believed is true, that God's going to prove faithful. And as I jump, I know he's going to catch me. God's ways are above our ways. Only he knows the future. With every act of faith, We're called to jump into the dark, and we do so because we know he has us. We do so knowing that even if it means difficulty, that even that is somehow part of his good and mysterious purpose. And that displays our third point. Be confident in God. As you think about the thing you're going through at the moment, kids, I know some of you are going through hard times as well, and growing up at your stage of life is a hard time in itself. Be ready that it's a testing time. Be faithful, even though you don't always know what God is doing. But above all, be confident in him. That's what shines out of this passage for me. And so having stopped Abraham, the Lord provides that substitute for Isaac, doesn't he? A ram caught in a thicket. And the point is stressed in verse 14. Abraham called the place, the Lord will provide. And to this day, it is said on the mountain of the Lord, it will be provided. Now, as Christians, we're supposed to think, hang on a minute, there's some links I'm making in my mind at this point. This is all going on 2,000 years before Jesus came. Abraham is ready to sacrifice his one and only son at the very spot where Jerusalem would be built, where there would be a temple with sacrifices being made, and ultimately, Jesus, the Lamb of God, would be pinned to a cross, as we remembered a couple of weeks ago, as God's one and only son is given for the sins of the world. On the very mountain, God provides a ram so that Isaac may go free. He provides his son, his only son, the son whom he loves, so that I and you might go free. Isn't that astonishing? Doesn't that give us confidence in our God? These are no coincidences. I'm sure you know how the master painters of the past would often sketch out what they're going to paint before doing the masterpiece. Here, God has sketched out the gospel with Abraham and Isaac before painting the masterpiece when he gives his own son in that same spot later. And the lesson is that no matter what call God calls us to, no matter what weight he asks us to lift, first, he can be trusted. He has some purpose in what he calls us to, even though we might not understand it. But second, he should be trusted because he's proved himself ready to give his utmost for us. This is no doubt why Abraham's confidence, can you see in verse 12, it's described as fear of God. Not to trust God can display, can't it, a lack of awe at who he is. But trusting him shows that above all, our priority is his pleasure, that we fear God. And all the darkness and the uncertainty of this life, the one thing we know, he's with us. He sees all. And we fear him in that reverent sense of knowing his bigness and with it his love. To think on how you know you need to trust and obey the Lord at the moment. You can't see how something's going to work out. Well, God knows. He'll provide a solution that will make sense in hindsight. He will attain the goal he has in your situation. And more than all else, of course, he does that by providing his son on Mount Moriah for us. And that's our final point. Be mindful as you go through your struggle of your salvation. That's why it was so wonderful singing a happy day and there is a place earlier. Because it's just good, isn't it, sometimes to rejoice in where we're going and keep our eyes fixed on that, actually, as we go through the tough time. To recognize as we're in the valley, the great view there is up on the hill. As we walk through darkness to see the light. So take a look from verse 15. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, I swear by myself. Wow. God's swearing by himself. There's no one more trustworthy by which to swear. I swear by myself. He's underlining this. That because you've done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed because you've obeyed me. Now, what's so interesting here is that God has always said to Abraham, I'm going to do this for you. But here it seems dependent on actually Abraham getting to this point of faith. But what you forget is that God has been a trainer. Over 30 years in the gym of discipleship, the Lord has brought Abraham to this point where he would display such exalted faith so that God would say, because of that, therefore I'm going to keep your promises. And the response from God is to reaffirm his covenant, his binding agreement with Abraham. He's made it, he's developed it, now he swears on it. He swears by himself. He will do what he's asked to do. He will bless Abraham and the world, us, through him. And he would do it on that very mountain. And when we're going through the mill, it is good to remember, isn't it, that because Christ, the faithful one, remained faithful to the last, and we are united to him, then God's covenant promises to us are so certain, aren't they? When we're going through the mill, to realize God's love can't be doubted, for he gave his son, his only son, the son he loved, on that mountain for us. And he did that so that one day, this 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, maybe 100 possibly years of struggle in the gym of discipleship, one day that's going to end. And then there's going to be an everlasting life of utter peace and joy with him because he gave his son. When we go through the mill, let's be mindful of our salvation, a salvation that gives us certain hope. And with it, God's very spirit now, giving us the wisdom we need to get through. At the cross, God does for us what he never asked Abraham to do in the end. That's how much he loves us. That's how much he is committed to us. And so he is worth it. He is worth the radical faith of Abraham. And as we express that kind of faith in the very faulting kind of way that Abraham did throughout his life, we can be sure that we are included in these great blessings. Let's have a moment then of quiet, a chance for you to respond to that. Might be a prayer of confession before the Lord, it might be a prayer of thanksgiving. Prayer for perhaps asking him to strengthen you as you go through your own trial with faith. But a moment for you to say your prayers. Heavenly Father, we acknowledge our smallness before you, but your great love for us displayed in Christ. And we pray, Father, that you would, in your great kindness, continue to train us in this gym of discipleship, giving us what we need for whatever you call us to. And by that, strengthening our faith for our good and for others. To be encouraged by. We do pray for those amongst us who are going through particular times of difficulty and trial. Father, we ask that they would look to you for what they need and find from you the strength to trust despite not fully understanding. And Lord, just as that mountain was called, the Lord will provide, we pray you provide for them in Christ, our sacrifice, all that they need, all wisdom, all strength, all endurance, all hope. And Lord, we do ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, musicians do come up. We're going to finish singing It Is Well With My Soul, which is just a wonderful reminder, isn't it? A way of saying, because of Jesus, our Isaac, who was slain, it is well with my soul. Let's stand and sing together.
When peace like a river attends my way, When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, you have taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. When Satan attacks me, when troubles come, let this blessed assurance that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul.
Standing for our final prayer. May the Lord direct our hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ. Amen. Please take your seats. That's the end of today's service. Please do hang around and have some refreshments and talk to each other. If anyone would like to pray about anything, something that you've maybe come to the service about or something that struck you during the service, I'll be down here at the front. I'm really happy to pray with everyone. And yeah, have a great week.